Good evening, everybody, and thank you so much for being here. You know, I've spoken and introduced so many different things in my life, but tonight is different. Tonight is very, very special. We've never really done something quite like this. And it's special because we are accustomed to speeches, storytelling by survivors. But now it is time to pass on to our next generation the storytelling and really what happened, the memories, and so on. And so tonight we decided that we would find and really work with 9 people who are children of survivors, 2 G's. And each one of them, in their own right, has accomplished enormous things. But they're not here so much today because of what they accomplished in our regular daily life and world. They're here because they are really the next generation to tell the story. And telling the story is never easy, and it's particularly not easy to tell it in public. So when you think about it today, 9 people will get up and tell a piece of some of their life of what it was like to be a 2G. And getting up and telling a private moment or an intimate moment in a public way is not very easy. It's not easy for any of us. And I ask myself, what is it really that allowed people, these wonderful people here, to get up and really talk about some aspect of their life in such a public way? And I realized what it was. It was Yiddishkeit. It was that necessity of telling the next generation about what their lives were like and what their parents' lives were like. It's the idea of passing on from generation to generation. That overcame their anxieties, I suggest, about coming up and telling 400 people and people on video and live stream tonight about their stories. So it's very, very special, and that is what I'm particularly thankful to the 9 of you to do that. It took a lot to be able to do that, but you know that we asked 9 people, and each one said yes immediately. And again, it's a Yiddishkeit of recognizing of the importance of passing on to the next generation the stories of their lives, of what it was like to grow up with parent or parents who were survivors. So that's a very, very important aspect, I think, of what you're going to hear tonight. But it's really more than that. I thought about, I have a grandchild, and I thought about Seder and him on my knee, and I thought my children on my knee, and I thought about my grandchild having his grandchildren on his knee at Seder. And that really is who we are. We are all about passing on memories, and that's what we're really here to hear tonight. So with that, I'd like to all of us to take a special thanks to the 9 of you who are so nice to share those moments of your lives with us for a few minutes and pass on to us some of your experiences, some of the cries, some of the laughter, but what it was really like growing up as the children of survivors. So I want to thank you from all of us. So thank you. Really special. Some other thank yous. I want to thank our museum director, David Marwell. So David has worked, from the first time he started here, he has worked with survivors, children of survivors, and grandchildren of survivors in a very caring and meaningful way. So David, we all thank you for that. Thank you. So. And we're being live streamed tonight, and I got emails from California, I got emails from a synagogue on the island, so were there a lot of people that are gonna be watching and listening, don't be nervous, they really wanna hear you, and you're wonderful people. So so I wanna thank a friend of mine, Charles Wong, who provided the ability to do the live streaming tonight. I wanna thank Alyssa Shine, who was spectacular in putting this together. And there's a very special person who I've known for a while. Her name is Bonnie Levison. Bonnie has done moth storytelling, and she's an expert storyteller. And I've had her work with me before, and she was so kind. She came and she, not that these incredible, extraordinary group of people need coaching on anything, but she helped, she coached, she got the stories into a kind of shape that I think you'll all find interesting. So Bonnie, I can't see where you are, but thank you very, very much. That's very nice. You're wonderful. And so now let me do something special, which is introduce somebody very special. His name is Amichai Lau-Lavie. And I met Amichai Lau-Lavie, who was the spiritual leader of the Lab Shul during the high holidays, about 4 or 5 months ago. Let me just a couple of words about him. He is going to be the moderator tonight, and he's also the child of a survivor. His father was Naftali Lau-Lavie, who who you will hear about. And his father was an exceptional man. I think it can be said in a few words, he was a righteous man. And that is the way, where are you? Can't see. There you are. He was a righteous man, and that is the way to think about your father, Naftali, and you will hear more about him. So he will moderate tonight, and there's so much that I could talk about Amichai. You'll get the sense of the person as he talks. But my sort of closing story is that I went to the High Holiday services for the first time. He had services over here at the Borough of Manhattan Community College. I walk in, and there's maybe 2,000 or 3,000 people there. And I have my five-year-old with me, and there are children's services. And I'm trying to take my grandchild, over to the children's services. But here's the music. He runs in to the actual adult services, and he plunks himself down at 5 years old. He says, "Poppy, can I sit on your lap?" "Yes." And for an hour and a half, he watched and listened to those beautiful, spiritual, musical services. No one has ever done that to any grandchild, I suggest, ever, except you. So, Amichai Lau-Lavie, thank you.
Good evening, Bruce, thank you. I'm glad that you ended with a story about Elijah, because we're talking, as you said here, about generational connections. And it is really an honor and a privilege to stand here tonight with friends, relatives, people who I've known for many years and just got to know, honoring the generations that were, and honoring the generations that are, and honoring the generations that are coming. So really, thank you for everyone who's been on stage and backstage making tonight happen, and welcome to all of you. I think we have here tonight some of us who are second generation Holocaust survivors. I think there are several people tonight who are actually Holocaust survivors, and we want to welcome you especially. And I know we have many friends and many people who are both here in person and online watching us. So welcome to all of us for being here tonight. I want to mention something about the occasion that has brought us here together. This event was supposed to have taken place just over a month ago, during the week that marked the 70th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz. And as you recall, it snowed a lot. Actually, not as much as they feared. But when we met just the week prior, it was decided that to make sure that this happens as it should, we will postpone. And we did, and here we are tonight. I didn't look at my Jewish calendar when this scheduled date was finalized, but I did a few weeks ago. And then I noticed that today on the Jewish calendar is the 7th of Adar, Zayin Adar, that actually has deep significance to what we're doing here tonight. The 7th of Adar is, Mazel Tov, the birthday of Moses. And it's also, I'm sorry to share with you, the death date of Moses. Happened on the same day. And Bruce mentioned righteousness. I think my father would blush. But I think to be a tzaddik in our tradition is someone whose death and birth happens at the same time. It's sort of a chesed. There's a real moment when the past and the future are meeting. So Moshe Rabbeinu is remembered today. And this has become the day of the Chevra Kadisha. All those in our communities all over the world who perform the kindness of taking care of those who've passed are honored and are honoring their work today. So the Zayin of Adar is a day of death, is a day of birth, is a day of honoring those of us who honor those who were. And I think we could not have picked, although I don't think we planned it such, but the powers that be helped us pick tonight as a perfect way to remember our ancestors, our parents, our role models, all who have passed, and I remember it here tonight. So I'm glad it worked out. I want to say one word about what I'm wearing. A few of you asked me in the lobby. I'm wearing a medal that my father, Naftali Lau-Lavie, Alav Shalom, received 10 years ago at the 60th anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz. He was interred there as well as in other camps. And in one of those ceremonies, medals were given. And my father came back to Jerusalem and said, "Great, I got a medal." And he said, "Of course, I'm never going to wear it." And it was sitting in his drawer. About 3 months ago, he passed, b'seiva tova, at a ripe old age. And as we went through some of what was there, there were a few medals. And I thought, well, an occasion will come up. So as we are marking the 70th, this is just one way to begin to grasp the heroism, the character, the righteousness, the ability to survive and to pass on the story that I received from my father, that my 9 colleagues will share with us tonight, and so many of us carry as well. This is really no way to capture the grandness, but it's a gesture. And that's what we're doing tonight, gestures. A word about what's happening tonight. 9 fantastic speakers, each with a personal story, will come up in just a few moments. Each of us has been instructed kindly by Bonnie to stick to 5 minutes max and to share a sliver of our story of what it was like to grow with our parents' legacy. Should we go over our 5 minutes? Our pianist over here, Daniel Rutkowski, who's already got us into the right mood, will gently play a few notes. You want to give us an example, perhaps? For instance, this is not the Oscars. So the evening can keep on flowing along. I will introduce each of the speakers briefly, and I think we will be able to get the whole picture of who's here, and afterwards we'll have time to talk more with all of us. I want to just 2 more thank yous before we begin. Bruce mentioned the online connection that we have here tonight, so I'm glad that some are watching us online, potentially my mother in Israel, although it's 2 a.m., but she said she might. So the folks at the Minetto Hill Jewish Center in Plainview, Long Island, are watching us tonight, and I want to thank them and many others who are, and I want to thank Ron Nunn from New Lion for making the live stream possible. Thank you. I know there's several people from that team here tonight. And I want to acknowledge one more teacher and friend and colleague, Menachem Rosensaft, who's here tonight, who's helped make tonight happen in many, many ways, and who, among other things, is celebrating a very important book called Faith and Identity from the Ashes, Reflections of Children and Grandchildren of Holocaust Survivor. It features the writings of several of us who are honored to be here tonight, and the book is on sale in the bookshop. And it's a very moving tribute, and it's an honor to be included in it. So Baruch Haba as well. So without further ado, I want to invite the first of our speakers here to share a story. Our first storyteller is the son of Dora Blaustein from Warsaw, and Nachman Libeskind from Łódź, as you pronounced it appropriately. His parents met in Siberia at the farthest edge of the Soviet Union, somewhere where China and Tibet met. And out of that, Daniel Libeskind will share with us his story.
Let me take you to a courtyard in Łódź, Poland. It's the early 50s. I'm standing in the room looking at a grim courtyard. Poland is not only under the dark cloud of communism, but state-controlled antisemitism. We feel it viscerally, at school, on the streets, from our neighbors. It's an eternal part of our dismal life in that city. Łódź had 250,000 Jews before the Holocaust. One of every 3 people in Łódź was Jewish. Now, there's virtually no one on the street who's Jewish. I'm standing at the window looking at the dim walls of that courtyard, which is closed. At the end of it, there is a wall. Against that wall, there is a stanchion of metal on which women all day long beat their carpets as if dust was the eternal reality of that city. And I'm standing at the window waiting for something I've dreamed about, the piano that my parents promised to bring to the house. My father appears at the door. He's carrying a suitcase. He opens the suitcase, and I see something that partially looks like a piano. There's a keyboard, but the rest I don't recognize. And he says to me, "You know, I brought you a piano and a suitcase. We can't bring a piano to the courtyard. Our neighbors are so hostile to us. There's so much hatred against us. They will always say the rich Jews brought the piano to the courtyard." And I think to myself in my 7-year-old head, how is it possible then this two-room apartment in which four of us live, which is not even big enough for a piano, could be thought to be owned by rich Jews. In any case, I fall in love with accordion. I become a virtuoso. I'm invited to play on the first television program when Polish television goes on air. Finally, we are off to Israel, promised land. We are at the station in Łódź. There's only one person who comes to say goodbye to us. It's Pan Stajkowski, my music teacher, who shakes my hand and tells me I have a great future in music. After arriving in Israel, I continue to study music. My music teacher says, Daniel, I've inscribed you into a music competition of the America-Israel Cultural Foundation for Music. On the appointed day, I show up at a big hall. There are hundreds of people, some very tall and very grown up, some younger, all carrying cellos, violins, drums, oboes, clarinets. No one is there with a suitcase. They enter a room where they are judged and come out with great frequency with forlorn faces. It's clearly difficult to win the scholarship. My name is called. My father carries the accordion and leaves the room. I strap the accordion to my body. It's 3.5 octaves. You can only see my head and my feet. 3 people in front of me look a little shocked. Mrs. Kosevitsky, the great patron of music, Zeno Franciscati, the Italian violinist, Isaac Stern, the head of the competition. They have quizzical expressions. One might even say cynical. They've never seen this instrument so close to their eyes. But their expressions change. On the third chord of the toccata in D minor of Bach, which I've transcribed, I see their expression have changed. And when I finish my performance with Rimsky-Korsakov, Flight of the Bumblebee, with its dazzling, bravura fingering of both the bass and the keyboard, they smile. Isaac Stern comes over to me. He puts his hand on my shoulder, and in a solicitous way said, "You know, Daniel, you've already exhausted the virtuosity of this instrument. You can go no further. You must go from the vertical to the horizontal. You must play the piano." Next thing I know, I'm standing with a small group of the winners, and next to me is a slightly older boy with crutches. It turns out to be Yitzhak Perelman. But Isaac Stern has planted a doubt in my mind. I feel like a jealous lover, somebody who was betrayed by the piano which never arrived. And I begin to slowly lose interest in that instrument. And I discover another instrument. It's a small piece of wood with an inserted piece of graphite. And with this pencil, I can evoke the worlds of music, the frozen music that remains on paper. And I become an architect. Many years later, I'm with a BBC crew in the same courtyard. The courtyard looks a little bit lighter. Still, the cracks are there. I walk to the end of the courtyard and ring the bell to my apartment. An old woman's head pops out of the window. And I say to her, "Pani pamięta rodzinę Libeskindów? Do you remember the Libeskind family?" She shakes her head vigorously. Perhaps she thinks we have come to reclaim something. And then she says, in Polish to me, "But I do remember a little boy who always played the accordion." And I say to her in Polish, "That little boy was me." And that very moment, I have a revelation that this courtyard, the accordion I played in it, the piano, which never, never arrived, form a triangle, form the coordinating points of a space in which my past, my future are so deeply intertwined. Thank you.
Well, the bar has been certainly raised. And we might need to ask you next time to come and actually play Bach, the accordion. So we're moving on to our next story, really deeply moved by this convergence. So our next storyteller, her father, Simcha Fogelman from Vilna, was part of the military police of the Red Army at the time of liberation. Her mother, Leah Borstein Fogelman, was in Tashkent when the war ended. And Eva Fogelman has been telling stories for a long time and teaching us about how to tell them. And tonight she'll share with us one of her own.
So, I'm sitting on a park bench with my father in Martha's Vineyard. It is 1977, and I'm in my mid-20s working at Harvard Medical School with heroin addicts. My side job is to lead groups for children of Holocaust survivors. Lo and behold, it is a warm, sunny day, and we're basking in the sun, but I'm also basking in my 15 minutes of fame. The New York Times Sunday Magazine had just written about my groups for children of Holocaust survivors, and it had a ripple effect way beyond the Holocaust survivor community. My father, for the past 2 years, had been dissuading me from not doing these groups. He said, no one's interested in the Holocaust, so why are you ruining your career? After the article came out, he changed his tune. Well, I guess at last Americans are finally interested what happened to Jews under Hitler. My mother had a different Holocaust saga, but that's for my next appearance. As we're enjoying the sun, all of a sudden my father blurts out, you see those berries? They remind me of the berries that I ate when I was in the woods before I became a partisan with the Belarusians. I felt like an animal. I thought I knew my father's ordeal. He was my hero. He was not an animal. All of a sudden, this newly minted expert on the Holocaust realized that I had a lot more to learn. I'm enjoying my conversation with my father. He's very excited that I'm on my way to Israel to participate in the International Psychoanalytic Association meeting. But I'm sitting there with trepidation, knowing that I have to tell him that on my way to Israel, I'm going to be stopping in Germany to see where he met my mother and where I was born. So I think that he's going to tell me not to go, but all of a sudden he blurts out, 52 Markstrasse. He had remembered it after all these many years. And it is several weeks later, I am standing in front of this house that had loomed so large in my imagination, even though I have no memory of it. I was only there for 4 months. As I am walking up the few steps, my heart is beating, and I'm standing in front of this semi-detached row house in Kassel, and it also has two floors, and it has an attic. And I knock on the door, and a gentleman comes out who is in his 60s, and of course, right away, I think about where was he during the war. And I let him know in my broken Yiddish that I try to Germanize that I was born here and I would like to see the house. He's so sorry, his wife is in the hospital, so he can't invite me in to tea. But I take a peek and I look in and I see this living room with Danish furniture and of course tchotchkes. And I walk away very disappointed. I look and I see that the backyard is completely covered with cement. No flowers, no plants, no trees. So I don't know what I'm going to do next. I walk around the corner and I see a post office box. And so I sit down on the ground and I begin writing a postcard to my parents. Remember that old tradition? All of a sudden, an elderly gentleman comes over to me who has a protruding stomach, looking very, very dapper, and wants to know what I'm doing here. So I let him know I was born here. And lo and behold, I'm being invited to his house with the rest of his family to have dinner. He then takes me on a tour of Kassel. I see the hospital where I was born. I see the Black Madonna in this beautiful park. When we part, I have the feeling that he wants me to come back and live in Kassel. Sometimes you meet the most unexpected people in places that you wouldn't think of. When I come back to New York, I'm sitting in my parents' kitchen, and of course they want to know about Kassel. When I tell my mother about the hospital, she says, that was a half-burnt-out building. And then she says, and when you were born, the nurse said, you Jews, all you ever do is have babies. I really felt that my mother must have been so scared when she had me. When I tell them about the cement, my mother chimes in and says, you know, when your father received all these medals when he was in the military police of the Red Army at the end of the war, we buried the medals in that yard because we were afraid the Germans would get him and arrest him. I couldn't believe that I had never heard that story before. I realized that even though liberation had happened, that living on German soil really did not provide a sense of freedom for the Jews. This conversation was the first of many to come. It changed the course of my career. I realized that I was much more tethered to listen and help the healing of Holocaust survivors and generations of the Holocaust than I was to feel helpless in working with heroin addicts who kept getting addicted and re-addicted over and over again. The Holocaust survivors, who they were and who they became, they were never animals. They were and continue to be human spirits worthy of our attention and our time, worthy of having their voices heard and their pain acknowledged. Thank you.
Elzbieta Benedict survived the war in the Budapest ghetto along with her mother. At the end of the war, she stood on a line for bread, and there a Russian soldier caught her eye. His name was Sam Yeshaya Kliger, a Polish Jew who somehow became a partisan and a Russian soldier, and there they met. A year later, they were married in Italy, and that's where Jack comes from. So this most unusual story of all fates meeting gives us another story tonight. Jack.
So I'm a trustee of the Museum of Jewish Heritage, proud to be so. But I'm here because I'm a child of survivors, and I'm an immigrant who came here with my family. When I was 3 years old, my parents had myself and my baby sister. And after we came to the United States, 2 years later, my mother had a third child, and that caused her to contract tuberculosis. And she was unfortunately had to be isolated immediately and was placed in a sanatorium in Bedford, in Upper Westchester. We had no family that could take care of us, and therefore my sisters were placed in foster care, and I, at the age of six, was placed in an orphanage. And I was there for, is that better? I was there for 2 years. We were reunited after 2 years. Our family came together again, and my parents, either they couldn't or they wouldn't discuss it and talk about it, but they decided they wanted to move on, and they wanted their family to move on. So for me, that was just an empty chapter in my life. There were no history, no stories, no memories, no photographs. And so we moved on. I was the first person in our family to graduate from college. I enjoyed a certain amount of career success, but I always had a very great fear of getting married and having children. I overcame that, and in my mid-30s, I did marry and have a child, and that inspired me to get involved with this organization. I worked with the organization for a number of years and was very committed to its mission of remembrance and education. Personal remembrance is sometimes a much harder thing than institutional remembrance. And I decided at first to try and find out about that place that I had been in for 2 years, and I This was 30 years ago, and I knew the name of the place was Homecrest, and I looked up the records. It was in Yonkers, New York, but unfortunately it had been closed and torn down and made into a shopping center, and that was all I did about that at the time. I went forward, and at one point decided that I wanted to interview my mother. My father, Shalom, passed away, but I wanted to interview my mother and hear more about her story, and this was from the first time that we actually talked about what had happened during that time, and she shared with me her sadness and her great shame at having gone through all of that and then not being able to take care of her own children. And I told her that there was nothing she could have done. She had no choice. And it was very important, I believe, for her to hear me say that and for me to tell her that. But that gave me another mission, and that was to find out more about my own experience. And this time, I had a much better set of research tools. I had the internet, and I also had a very committed nephew to help me do my research. And we went online, and we found a tremendous amount of information about Homecrest. Homecrest was actually the Hebrew National Orphans Home, established in 1912 on the Lower East Side to help orphans and children destitute children whose parents could not take care of them, many of them from immigrant families. And 40 years later, I think I was one of the last immigrant children to be put up in the home. But I found an amazing amount of information about the Hebrew National Orphans Home. It was an incredible institution. At one time, it had an active alumni association that had over 1,000 Jewish men who had been taken in as boys by the home. They sold out the Waldorf Astoria for dinners once a year. Famous writers like E.M. Nathanson, who wrote The Dirty Dozen, had been at the home. In fact, the Hebrew National Orphans Home had some of the best basketball players in Westchester. They played with jerseys that said HNOH with a Star of David underneath. And in fact, they were the feeding ground for Roosevelt High School, which was right next door. And in the early 50s, Roosevelt High School won a regional championship, and 4 of the 5 starters were boys from Hebrew National Orphan Home. One name kept popping out, Rick Safran. He had written a book about growing up as an orphan. He had also been the editor of the alumni newsletter. And with the help of my nephew, I tracked down Rick, and actually he was living in Manhattan and a retired school principal, lived there with his wife, Shirley. And I got in touch with Rick, we met, we had a wonderful set of meetings. I felt an immediate intimacy with him, even though we had never met before. He left just as I had arrived in 1953. And through Rick, I was able to connect with Eugene Suttenberg, who had been my bunkmate in the home. And we met. Eugene lives in Wilton, Connecticut, and the three of us got together, have shared many stories, many memories. And in fact, Rick found a photograph of me that was the first photo that I had ever seen of one of the women from the Ladies Auxiliary taking me out on my 7th birthday at the home. So I spent most of my life with that story being an empty chapter in my life and feeling very disconnected and feeling that it was a dark place. And I felt now that having met people who had shared my experience and who I felt I was connected with, the darkness turned into more light. My mother and I have made peace on this, and I have photographs, I have memories, and I have stories. And I thought that that story was very appropriate to tell in this place, which is dedicated to our shared experience and our shared history. And the credo of the home was survive, grow, and flourish. I think he gave me some very good lessons. I'm very glad that my lovely wife, Amy, is here tonight, but I'm also very glad that my new old friend, Rick Safran, and his wife, Shirley, are here tonight. Thank you.
If you haven't taken a deep breath in the last few minutes, this is a lot. We're like rummaging through this treasure box of memories that are both intensely personal, but tonight they're becoming collective, and it's a huge privilege. I want to introduce our next speaker, who hails from the aristocracy of Jewish Poland with over 200 years of important leadership. And her story is that of her parents, Devorah Levin from the Moskowitz family, was born in Warsaw and liberated in 45. And Rabbi Yehuda Leiv Levin, who left just 1940 to Palestine, to Eretz Israel. And what Ruth Lichtenstein has to offer us tonight is not just a story of what was, but something about what's happening with it now. So it's really an honor to welcome almost Mishpocha, certainly a friend.
Good evening. I was about 7 years old when the Eichmann trial began in Jerusalem. One day, during the course of the trial, I heard a knock on the door. There stood Leibel, a man who we considered as our uncle. During the Holocaust, Leibel had spent 6 months with my mother and her brother in a bunker in Warsaw, then almost entirely reduced to rubble by the Nazis. Now, at the time of Eichmann trial, the same Leibel stood there at the door, looking shaken, on the verge of tears. The moment my parents saw him, they took him into the dining room and locked the door. And a few moments later, I heard bitter sobbing. It was Leibel. As a little girl, I couldn't understand why Leibel was crying. But as an adult, I learned slowly and painfully all about the Holocaust. And then I understood that my parents, whom I loved so much, and their friends, whom I respected so much, had emerged alive but deeply scarred from a unique form of hell. It took me many years to understand that the survivors, or at least some of them, put a kind of a mask in order to pretend to the world outside, to themselves and to us, the children, that life is going on and everything is fine. Only as an adult did I finally begin to understand the trauma that the Eichmann trial represented to survivors, because it forced them to confront the pain that they carried within them. And that's why Leibel was crying. But Leibel was not the only survivor who left such an impact on me. I'm a proud child of two Holocaust survivors. My father, Rabbi Yehuda Leib Levin, left Poland in April 1940, hoping to be reunited with his first wife and their child soon. Unfortunately, they were murdered by the Nazis in Auschwitz just 4 months before liberation. My mother, Dvorah Levin, named Mostovich, was 10 when the war broke out and was almost 16 when she was liberated. She, together with the only surviving brother, went through forced labor camps, hiding places, even swimming through the sewer system of Warsaw at the time of the Polish uprising. They faced many times death, and her brother was the one who always saved her by the last minute. Finally, they were liberated, but it took only 2 hours after liberation when her brother was arrested by the Soviets on suspicion that he was a Volksdeutsche who had collaborated with the Nazis. My mother found herself a sole survivor of her family. Owning nothing but a knapsack, she decided to leave Poland. As she told me, I decided to walk to Eretz Israel, Palestine then. And she made her way to Bucharest, Romania, where she had waited together with many other thousands for the certificate to come. Finally, the unbelievable happened. The certificates arrived. And she went to the office to pick up her certificate, looked in it, walked out, sat down on the steps, and began to cry. A woman passed by, and she wanted to know why she was crying. But my mother, who has gone through too much for a girl her age, refused to answer. Again and again, the woman insisted on knowing why she was crying. Because, came the tearful answer, they want me to travel on Shabbos. You come with me, said the woman. This was Rebetzin Shulman of Slobodka, Lithuania, and she took her to the people in charge of the certificates, and she told them, you know, you want to build a new life in Israel. Even a new museum deserves old artifacts. Take her as an ancient artifact, as a symbol of Shabbos. And so they did. My mother was a very special woman. No one was there to tell her to which way of life to go, how to continue. She, on her own, never ever changed any traditions that she saw at home. Back in Israel, she married my beloved father, a man with profound faith and great intellect, and together they built a very, very, very happy home. I think that her story left a tremendous impact on me for life, and it is for that that I feel that I owe a great debt of gratitude to my beloved parents and to their friends like Leibel and others for their strength, faith, and inspiration, which they saw in it not only a way of life, but a kind of victory over the Nazis' efforts to destroy the nation of Israel. I was only 25 when my beloved father passed away at the age of 60. When I got up from the Shiva, the morning period, I promised myself to continue what my father had undertaken, the mission to teach, to explain, and to make sure that the younger generation should also understand why Leibel and people like him had been sobbing so bitterly. Thank you.
One line from Ruthie's story really struck out for me here tonight. Every new museum deserves an old artifact. There's a poem by Yehuda Amichai. Sorry? Daniel Libeskind had to leave. I apologize. There's a poem by Yehuda Amichai, one of Israel's premier poets who passed away just a number of years ago. And it's called an ancient synagogue inside a new museum. And I think it's apropos for tonight. I'll say it briefly. It says, inside the modern museum, an ancient synagogue. Inside the synagogue, me. Inside me, my heart. Inside my heart, a modern museum. It's an ongoing poem. And I think tonight we are in a modern museum, but in a way, we have a minion of mourners and rememberers telling the story. So not exactly a synagogue, but it's a mikdash me'at. It's a mini temple of memory. And thank you for sharing yours. Our next story. Sarah Waxman and Isaac Norich were a couple before the war. But then in 1945, she from Bergen-Belsen and he from Dachau miraculously met again. And Sam Norich is here to share some of that incredible story.
In 1998, a few months after my appointment as chief executive of the Forward Association was announced in our Yiddish and English newspapers, a man whom I had never heard of before or never met came and asked to see me. He said that his name was Simcha Brudno. He came from Chicago. He was a Lithuanian Jew from Shavel, Shaulai, and he had been liberated together with my father on the death march from Dachau, and had lived in the same DP camp where my father became the camp director for the next 4 years in Feldafing, where I was born. And he said that he wanted to tell me about my father, the kind of man he was during those 4 years. I had, of course, known the outlines of my parents' biography. They had met in a socialist Zionist youth movement of Linke Poalition, of the left workers of Zion, in Łódź in the mid-30s, during their late teens. They had survived the Łódź ghetto and different concentration camps, even though most of their families had not. And they had found each other after liberation. I have a letter that my mother wrote to my father in May of 45 when she learned that he was still alive. My father went to work in Feldafing. He was elected actually to the camp committee, and he was the first, I think, to head the employment office, then the housing office, and then he was elected as chair of the camp committee. And after he left Poalition Smol in 48 over some internal squabble, he was hired by the JDC to be director of Feldafing, which was the largest DP camp in Germany. There was a mystery in my parents' lives, and that was why we had arrived in the States only in 1957. Most of the DPs that I grew up with, most of the children of survivors that I knew, came in 49, 50. Why did it take us until 57? And the explanation that I had been given was that, first of all, I was hospitalized frequently in my first 3 years, and my parents didn't want to leave the Munich hospitals. By the time I got well in 1950 and they were ready to go to Israel, my father's brother had gone in 49, and my father was sending him food from the DP camp. This was the time of the Tzena in Israel. And my father didn't think that he could hack doing physical labor as his brother was doing, and he couldn't get a guarantee of an office job once he arrived in Israel. So he decided not to go and to apply for an American visa instead. And in 51, when he applied, he was asked to sign a letter. The American intelligence authorities, of course, had known that he had been a member, a leader of Poalition Smol. And they said, if you sign a letter that you were a member of a pro-communist organization and you no longer are, we'll let you have a visa. And my father said, we were never pro-communist. We would fight with the communists in the streets of Łódź. And he refused to sign the letter. And he would apply yearly, and they would ask the same thing of him, and he would give the same answer. But I wondered once, or more than once, why he didn't just sign the letter, even though it wasn't true. We would have gotten to America 6 years earlier. Eventually, a month after Eisenhower's second inaugural, somebody in American intelligence in Frankfurt looked at his file and said, this is wrong. if the guy had been a communist, you were letting him off the hook. You were giving him a visa. Why wouldn't he sign? So they called him in and said, okay, you don't need to sign any letter. Do you still want a visa? Now, we had lived in Fehrenwald, the last Jewish DP camp in Germany, until September 56. And we had moved, we'd given up. We had given up on getting an American visa and moved into a new apartment in Bogenhausen in Munich. And 5 months later, my father got this offer. And 3 weeks after that, we were in New York. But this man, Simcha Brudno, came to tell me something that I knew, but I didn't know in the way that he could tell it. He came and he said, you know, your father was an honest man. He didn't make promises that he couldn't keep, and he kept the ones he made. He tried to help people whenever he could, but he was a man of his word. And I thanked Simcha Brudno. I felt in that moment that this was an angel sent to tell me about my father. And I actually spoke about Simcha Brudno at my father's funeral 10 years later. It was not only my gratitude for that, it was also because, of course, he wouldn't have misrepresented who he had been. Even though it might have gotten us into America far earlier. My father knew who he was, and that was not going to change. Thank you.
So I was asked to share a couple of words about my father, Naftali Lau-Lavie. He was born in 1929 in Krakow, went through quite an arduous journey of which he had written, and survived not only by himself, but making sure that his younger brother survived as well, and with him the rabbinic lineage. That was my grandfather's legacy to my father in 1942, just before they parted ways. My grandfather, who was a rabbi as well, and a lineage, a link in a long lineage of rabbis, wanted my father to make sure that somebody continues the rabbinic lineage. I think both he and my father already then knew that it's probably not going to be my father. And so the younger brother, who grew to be indeed a very important rabbi in Israel, was guarded by my father as a precious treasure. They both made it to Eretz Yisrael on the first boat out of Europe in 1945. So I want to share one tiny story about my father since he just passed away recently. It's still a little raw. But bearing in mind that Purim is next week, my father had a healthy sense of humor. And he was a hero. He didn't talk about his experience until I was well into my late teens. We only had some versions of what happened. And I think, as many of us here in the room who are second and even third generation know, when things are not spoken of, truths fester. So there were a lot of ways that many of us have found to deal with those unspoken stories, some of them perhaps healthier than others. I think it is not a coincidence, and Menachem, I wonder what you think, that a lot of second generation folks went into caretaking modes, from being storytellers and therapists to leaders to teachers, as a way to take on the legacy. Well, I at some point in my life took on a peculiar choice of dealing with my father's legacy and the horrors of the Shoah. And on Purim in the late 90s, on probably a little too much drinking, but it is the mitzvah of the day, put on a costume and emerged on Purim as a rebbetzin, as the esteemed widow of several rabbis. It was Purim, it was allowed. As a matter of fact, Alyssa may have repressed that night, I have, but we even performed here one night. And Rebbitz and Hadassah Gross was a theatrical way of dealing with unspoken truths and some of my own issues. As a drag persona, she emerged in the late 90s, performed throughout a few years, and at some point it was sort of assumed, and we did not deny, that since she was a Rebbitzin who was religious and in her 70s, she had been a Holocaust survivor. And that was a little scandalous. It was out there, but it was a way to say very terrible things through humor and touch some of the unspoken horror through also the mask of theater. And so it was. In 2006, Haaretz ran a large story on Hadassah Gross with a cover photo and interviewed my father. Unbeknownst to me, my father, bless him, said only one line for the interview. They said, "How do you feel about Hadassah Gross?" And he said, "Hadassah Gross has great legs." I will say, I was wondering about the Polish-Hungarian shidduch we heard here before. My father was a Polish man. Many of you know, Polish men, Hungarian women. There's both a love and a hate situation going on there. Why Hadassah was Hungarian, that's anyone's guess. I won't get into that right now. But that moment in the conversation my father and I were able to have with humor about me and my paths, about he and his, came to a fantastic moment. A few months later, I was in Yerushalayim. My father and I took a walk to Yad Vashem. Father was on the board of Yad Vashem. His story is recorded there on the walls, in the archives. And it gave him some sense of peace to go there and to see visitors, and to see the trees, and to be able to walk out and be in Yerushalayim, in a Jerusalem, which is a thriving city. So that was one of the places where we went out for a walk. Odd, but those of you who know what I'm talking about know that it didn't feel so abnormal at the time. The new wing just opened, and he and I are walking around, and suddenly he calls me over, and he's chuckling. I'm like, what's going on? There's a wall of photographs of people who lived in Europe prior to the wall, 20s and 30s, and there is a photograph of a very pretty young woman, and the caption says, Hadassah Gross. And my father says, do you know this lady? And I said, no, we must research. Anyway, we both burst out laughing. It was sort of outrageous. And at that moment, I'll mention name, one of the prominent heads of the museum walks by and says, Naftali, why are you laughing? And my father looked at him and looked at me and he said, you won't understand. And it's a tiny moment in a much longer and complicated legacy of love. But that moment of humor, that moment of acceptance of the ineffability and ways of dealing with it, for me remains as maybe not a medal, but a fond memory. This coming Purim Hadassah will not emerge, but the story lives on. So thank you. Which brings us to the next story. Sala Feliger and Itzik Perel were Polish Jews, Polish Yidden, who wound up in the camps. Sala was in the woods for an entire year, and then 4 years in camps. Itzik spent time in 14 camps, 6 months in Siberia. At the end of the war, they met, somehow ended up in Belgium, and Esther Perel, who's a dear friend and a great teacher and healer to many of us, is here tonight to share something about their story and hers.
Most Sunday afternoons, my parents would play cards, buraco. And they would invite friends to come over. My mother would bake her crumb cake and they would drink tea, boiling tea, which you took a piece of sugar, you put it in the mouth, and then you drank the hot water over the piece of sugar. Some of you must know that tradition. I could never understand how they couldn't burn their mouth. And as they would play the cards, somebody would say, so whatever happened to Moshe Strauss? Der ist verbrennt, der ist vermordet. This one was gassed, this one was murdered. And this was just like, there was no rating system in my house. no filters. Stuff and information was just passed on as if you were talking about the weather. And I remember hearing these conversations, half in Yiddish, half in English, and a little bit like, this one he didn't manage well, and er hat sich ein Eize gegeben, and er hat sich nicht ein Eize gegeben, and this one managed, and this one was not dumb gad. And it was this kind of, you know, conversations about how people lived in the camps. My parents had absolutely no sense of child development. Of when you should tell a story to whom, when, what, and so forth. If I asked my mother around age 4 what was the number on the arms, she just flat out would say, Auschwitz, you know. And then I had to ask, what was Auschwitz? If I said, why didn't I have grandparents? She said, vergast and vermordet. It just would, like, you know. Child development didn't enter into my parents, but it also took a long time to enter into me. And their concept of protection had nothing to do with being next to you if something bad was to happen. Their concept of protectiveness was that I should be able to survive if they're not around. So protectiveness was to leave me completely on my own so I could figure it out. But if I tell you that so many of the children in Antwerp pretty much had the same notion, all of this to us seemed completely normal. In fact, I never heard the word 2G or second generation until I met Eva Fogelman, which was years later in America. So in my community in Antwerp, there were two groups of people, those who did not die and those who came back to life. Those who did not die were the people whose homes I would go to, and it was morbid. Plastics on the couches, and people who lived rather tethered to the ground, not able to trust anybody, and certainly not able to enjoy too much, because if you were enjoying, it meant you were not watching out. And you never knew what could happen, so you couldn't really have too much pleasure without too much guilt. And those who came back to life, of which my parents were part of, really decided that they were going to embrace life with zest. But so much so that all the stories would mix. Years later, I'm in New York, I have one boy, I think I by then have two boys, but my older son, Adam, is voraciously watching and reading about the Titanic. And he's asking me questions all the time. And all I think is, he's curious, he must be like me, he's asking a lot of questions. And when he says, and what happened, I give him the facts, and that many people died, and that many people jumped, and only a few of them could get on the raft. And I'm thinking, and you know, and he's getting more and more agitated, and I don't understand why. Because I know, don't have a sense of child development either. Nobody protected me, nobody protects him. Nobody told me this will not happen again. How did I know this? I should say something like that. So my husband Jack comes to me and he says, maybe you should tell him that the Titanic only happened once. You know, it doesn't happen every day, you know. And so I went, and seriously, it didn't occur to me that one could reassure a child and one could say it won't happen again, because nobody ever bothered telling me it won't happen again. And not only was it like that, but it was also the sense that you can't be too vulnerable about it. Because the rule was this, the vulnerable die. So you either have to be very, very strong or you don't make it. And then I decided, here I am, on the one hand, telling their story because I do want to tell the intergenerational legacy of all of this, but I also wanted to tell where I decided to break the intergenerational legacy and where I chose to make a repair, which was that I was going to give the permission to my kids to be vulnerable and that I was not going to just prepare them for survival in case they land in the camps, because that's not the life that I wanted to pass on to them. And so I find myself wanting to repeat some stories and wanting to leave others behind. Thank you.
When he was 18 years old, Henry Landman, a German Jew, found himself in Dachau in 1938. In 1945, as an American soldier, he's one of the liberators of Dachau. Lisa Landman, his wife, came from Nuremberg with her family and fled in 1939. The 60th anniversary would have been just now, but a month ago, Henry passed away. And Rick is here tonight, their son, to share what must be difficult, but is an incredible story. So Rick, please join us.
So as I was just, as was just said, about 3 months ago, my father got an invitation from the Dachau Memorial Museum, and he was very excited about it. And he goes, "Ricky, we invited 2 tickets. We can go to Dachau. If you want to come with me in April, they're doing a 70th anniversary." And I was a little bit skeptical because Dad was getting a bit frail. He was 94 and a half. So I wasn't really all that enthusiastic about it. And he looks at me and goes, "No, the food is much better now." So, as you can see from some of the other speakers, humor is what kept my father alive and what is in me today. When he was arrested on Kristallnacht and he was put up against the wall to be shot at 18 years old, they didn't shoot him. He looked up and he saw the guard. They didn't shoot him. 5 minutes went by. 6 minutes went by. My father figured, as ein typischer Deutscher, this is rude. If they say they're going to shoot you, they should shoot you. And then he said to himself, "I wonder what's the worst thing that could happen? Shoot me?" So he walked slowly backwards, and another tall man took him and put him behind him, and my father was not shot and in Dachau. I also want to talk a little bit about my mother's side of the family. My opa fought in World War I for the Kaiser and was a very proud Jew. They come from Court Juden for 400 years in Germany. He was a virulent anti-Nazi to the point that he had to flee because the SA was coming up the street to arrest him in March of 33. So my mother's side of the family survived, my father's side of the family didn't. But one side thing, my grandfather brought a Torah to America, and I was supposed to donate it at my bar mitzvah in 1965. But I had a fight with my Hebrew school teacher over gay marriage. I raised my hand in class to ask if there was a blessing for 2 boys to get married because I wasn't into girls. They yelled at me so that I said, "They're not getting the Torah." My mother, in 1973, heard about Congregation Bet Simchas Torah and said, "You said one day there'd be a gay shul? There is. Get dressed and go to shul." So my mother sent me to CBST in 1973. 10 years ago, I sent that Torah back to Munich to Congregation Beth Shalom, an egalitarian liberal congregation. And although he's not here, Daniel Libeskind is the architect who's going to be designing and building the new building for my other shul in Munich in Beth Shalom. But what I'm going to talk to you about tonight happened exactly on this day, February 26, in 1971. I called up my parents because it was their Erev anniversary. Tomorrow would be my parents' 68th anniversary. But I had to call them up because I had my first real boyfriend. And my father, of course, joked that the man was Jewish and was going to be a doctor. But that I was planning on going on the first march, statewide march in this country for gay rights in Albany on March 14th of 71, and that I might get arrested or tear gassed again or beaten. And I wanted them to understand that this is now, might even make the front page of the paper kind of thing. And that night my father listened and said, "Ricky, I want to tell you, when I was your age, I'd come home from school, they want to beat me up, I'd go to my mother and I'd say, 'What the hell did the Jews do? What did we do? The teacher says we're no good. The doctors, the politicians, they say we're animals. What did the Jews do?'" And he said, his mother said to him, "Nothing. The whole world is wrong." you have to love yourself. You have to have a life that might be harder but richer, but the whole world is wrong. And in 1971, he said to me, Ricky, the doctors, the politicians, everyone says homosexuals are no good. But you're still my son. The whole world is wrong. You have to be strong, and you have to know that we love you, and that your life will be harder, but we are behind you. So that's why now, in 2015, when people say, how the hell did you go to the March on Albany in 71, and I was an organizer on the March on Washington for Lesbian and Gay Rights in 79, and I've been on the legal law clinics, and I was with CBST, and how have you done this? I was also one of the founders of the Gay Liberation Front in my college in 1970, and I realized it's because of my parents. The lessons they learned from the Holocaust was do not dehumanize anyone, and that you have to realize you have to love yourself. And I went back with my parents to Germany several times, because my father is the mayor in exile of Augsburg. He was also the first American soldier to enter Augsburg. And when we were there, I would wonder, when we'd see older Germans, what did you think about after the war? Did it ever scratch your head and say, why did we spend so much time and energy hating Jews, let alone killing Jews? Why did we hate our neighbors so much? And what I want to leave you with is that never again should mean for everyone. And I hope in our world, in our day, people start scratching their heads going, why are we spending so much energy making our LGBT family members and friends having such a difficult time? Just like the Germans had to realize what they did was such a terrible thing, isn't it about time that we move on and remember that the whole world is wrong for hating, for dehumanizing, and we start accepting people? And for my dad, I say thank you.
Rachel Berger fled Warsaw along with her brother and ended up in the Ural Mountains. Markus Berger, in Poland, found himself eventually drafted into the Soviet Army, and they met somewhere in the Ural Mountains. The story is much more complicated, and a craft expert storyteller, their son Joe Berger, is here with us tonight to tell a little bit of then and now.
When I was in the second grade, my class in yeshiva put on a play for George Washington's birthday. It was a series of sketches about his life, and I was asked to play George Washington in the legend about how he chopped down the cherry tree and told his father, "It was me, father, I cannot tell a lie." I was very excited. You have to understand, I had been in this country only 2 years. I didn't speak English all that well. My parents didn't speak English practically at all. And here I was being asked to play George Washington. So I ran home and said, "Ma, I'm going to be George Washington in a play." She looks at me with this anxious, frazzled expression. "Who was George Washington?" I said, "He was a general." I probably said he was a general because in the second grade, being a general was more impressive than being a president. My My mother said, a general? He said, yeah, Ma, he was a general. He was in the Revolutionary War. And I need a costume. He said, a costume? What does your teacher want from me? Who has the time to make you a costume? You have to understand, my mother at this in this time was a very anxious woman. She'd lost her entire family, save for one brother, in the Holocaust, and she came from a large family. Her husband had lost his family as well. She was anxious, she was nervous, and she worked besides. My father worked, but she worked too. She worked as a hat maker in the garment center, stitching hats that women wore during Easter. Now she had this extra burden. She had to make me a costume. But she never wanted me to feel, and this was one of the first English words I remember her learning, inferior. She wanted me to feel the equal of all the other kids in the class, so she decided to go out and make sure I had a costume. Took me to a used clothing store on 104th Street and Columbus Avenue, right near where we lived, and people were pouring through the bins and boxes for old clothes, and she saw a GI uniform hanging there. It must have been left by somebody who had been in World War II, or maybe the Korean War by this point. But she bought it for 50 cents or 75 cents, took it home, and she was a very good seamstress. She measured the swatches against my body and made me a midget-sized GI uniform. I looked in the mirror and I thought I looked terrific. When my father came home, he let out this huge laugh. Here his son was looking like a GI, and he said, you know, I have a good idea. He ran upstairs. We had a Puerto Rican neighbor, Junior. Junior had an army hat. I think he was stationed at Fort Dix. My father came down with Junior's parade army hat, put the leather cap on me, and I looked terrific. I looked like a little GI. The next day, I came to school, and my teacher, Mrs. Hansel, looked at me with a puzzled expression. And that upset me because I thought, here we are, we're showing our refugee ignorance again. Our refugee awkwardness. I'd seen it many times. I could tell you many stories. And I was upset. But then she suddenly began to smile, and she said, you know, when you tell the audience, it was me, Father, I cannot tell a lie, I want you to give a little salute. And so I played George Washington chopping down a papier-mâché cherry tree in a GI uniform. My mother was working that day and couldn't see my performance. I only wish she had, because when I gave that salute, I brought the house down. Thank you very much.
We're almost done. Our last storyteller for this night is the third generation of surviving this story. And with all the laughter and the tears tonight, I think we can all agree that telling these stories, just like we will be doing at the Seder in just about a month, is probably the most honorable way to remember, with smiles, with tears, but not forgetting. So our last storyteller tonight is the granddaughter of Milton and Dora Butnick, who were liberated from Bergen-Belsen in April 1945. And Stephanie is an accomplished storyteller. We're looking forward to you helping us to wrap up tonight.
As a teenager on Long Island, my biggest issue was whether I was more of an NSYNC fan or a Backstreet Boys fan. I was your regular teenage girl. One day after school, I wandered into a small room in the front of my parents' house. It was a small room tucked off the stairway, and in it were pictures of my grandparents, Milton and Dora Butnick, who had died when I was 5 years old. Some days I found myself drawn to this mysterious room, and I'd go inside and stare at photographs, black and white photographs, of early gatherings of Holocaust survivors. On that day, though, I noticed something I had never seen before. On the wall, with all the photographs, was a telegram from Elie Wiesel. It was yellowed and faded, and through the frame you could see the crease where it had once been folded. The telegram was sent to my grandparents shortly after I was born. The message read, "May Stephanie bring great joy and pride to her parents, grandparents, and all their friends." Wait, did Elie Wiesel send a telegram about me? Like any self-absorbed teenager, this was all about me. But then I reread the message, and the weight of it hit me. I had to honor my grandparents' legacy. I had to make my grandparents proud. And I had to do it all on my own. I did everything I could. I read every book I could get my hands on, from Devil's Arithmetic, Number of the Stars, Diary of Anne Frank, Night. I entered an essay contest at my temple for Holocaust Remembrance Day. In the essay, I railed against the idea of owning German cars. I won first place. I participated in an Adopt-a-Survivor program, and each week after school would listen to the story of a partisan fighter in Poland, where my grandparents had been from. Throughout high school, I carried with me this weighty burden that I felt no one could understand. After all, that telegram was for me. That legacy was mine. When I was a senior in high school, I went with my family to Germany for the 60th anniversary of the liberation of the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. The trip was sponsored by the local German government, and we were about three busfuls of people, mostly survivors of the camps, but a few families. But here, among all these people, I felt more alone than ever. That's because all the other families were there with their grandparents. I remember the day we visited the camp was gray and cloudy. The camp itself was torn down, was burned down upon liberation. That's how bad the conditions were. And all that remained were stone markers describing what had once been there. As I walked down the path between what had once been a row of barracks, I felt the ground crunching beneath my feet. It was as though the dirt was creaking with the weight of these new visitors. It was then that I heard something that one of the trip's organizers, Menachem Rosensaft, said. He was a child of Holocaust survivors and was born in the Displaced Persons camp nearby. I don't know if he meant it to be overheard, but I did hear him. He said, "It always rains when we come to Bergen-Belsen. It always rains when we come to Bergen-Belsen." In that moment, I realized I wasn't alone at all. I had never been. Here we were, all of us, in this horrible place, grappling with our complicated legacies. This isolating burden I had felt wasn't mine alone. It never had been. Today, that telegram hangs on the wall in my apartment not too far away. I see it every morning as I leave for work. But it's no longer a burden. To me, it's an inspiration. And I think that's what would make my grandparents proud. Thank you.
So as Stephanie just shared with us, tonight it is a privilege and honor to stand here as a we. And just as we wrap up this powerful night, I want to first thank David, Alyssa, the folks at the museum who've made tonight possible, Bruce for being a shepherd of so many great new things happening in the world, including here. All of you for coming, all of you for watching. And I'd like to ask us to close tonight with a moment of memory together a minion of us, 10, have shared memories of our parents tonight. So I want to first ask those of us who shared stories tonight to please rise and stand for just a moment. And I want to invite the rest of us to rise as well and to conclude tonight, not with a mourner's Kaddish, but with a moment of silence, that we will end with just a word of prayer for peace and music that will lead us outside, where we will do what we do best, eat something, drink something, and be a we together. So please join us for just 30 seconds of quiet, honoring all the incredible legacies we heard tonight and all the ones that were not heard tonight but are in our hearts. Ose shalom bimromav, hu yase shalom aleinu ve'al kol Yisrael ve'al kol yoshvei tevel ve'imru. Amen. Thank you. Good night.